where we're going to be talking about God's provision. We're going to talk about a little bit of partyology here. Do you know that God has instituted parties for his glory? God has instituted parties for his glory. And so last week, we jumped into this series by looking at the feast or the festival of booths. And we celebrated the fact as God put this festival in place, this feast in place for the people of God to always remember God's provision of protection. God's provision of protection. This week, we're going to look at the Feast of Passover. The Feast of Passover, we're going to look in Exodus chapter 12, verse 1 through 14, and we're going to consider this amazing text and celebrate how God has provided deliverance. How God has provided deliverance. God hears the cries of the people of Israel. Do you know that he hears your cries? And he hears the cries of the people of Israel, and he sends his servant Moses. And so Moses comes, even though he reluctantly comes, remember? He doesn't want to do this. He doesn't feel like he has the ability to do this. Side note, God's always in the business of calling you to do things that are beyond you. Because he wants to get all glory. God's not going to give you an assignment in life that you get all the credit for. God's going to give you things that stretch you, that push you out of your comfort zone. Moses was called by God to go back to Egypt, and Moses brought the word of God to Pharaoh, but Pharaoh stubbornly rejects these words. So you can go read about this in the book of Exodus, but as a result, the Lord sends the plagues, right? The blood, the frogs, the gnats, the flies, the livestock, boils, the hail and lightning, the locusts, the darkness, and the death of the firstborn sons. So we come to this Feast of Passover, remembering how God passed over the people of Israel, those in whom listened to the word of God, and those in whom by faith believed and obeyed the word of God. This Feast of Passover, held on the month of Nisan 14, is a celebration of deliverance. Let's go into the word of God and look at how the Lord has provided deliverance. Exodus chapter 12, verse 1 says this. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall be for you the beginning of months, and it shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell all the congregation of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, every man shall take a lamb according to their father's house, a lamb for a household." Don't forget the symbolism here of a lamb. And it says in verse 4, "And if the household is too small for a lamb, then he and his nearest neighbor shall take according to the number of persons," communities all throughout Scripture. You're not supposed to live alone. "According to what each can eat, you shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male a year old. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it until the 14th day of this month, when the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill their lambs at twilight." Very specific here. Remember, this is the word of the Lord. And it says, "Then they shall take some blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat." Verse 8, "They shall eat the flesh that night, roasted on the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs, they shall eat it. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted, its head with its legs and its inner parts. And you shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning you shall burn. In this manner you shall eat it, with your belt fastened, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. You shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover." So here in this text, each Israelite family is instructed to slay a lamb on the 14th of the first month of the Hebrew calendar in the spring. And its blood must be sprinkled on the doorpost. Verse 12. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and on the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. Throughout Scripture, you don't see God declaring things, saying, would you make me Lord? No, he is Lord. We don't make God Lord. He is Lord. I am the Lord. Verse 13, the blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. This Passover. Deliverance. And no plague will befall you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. Here, the Lord warns the people that he will kill all the firstborn sons and the firstborn male animals in the land of Egypt. But he reassures them that when he sees the blood, he will pass over, sparing the firstborn from every home. Verse 14. This day shall be for you a memorial day. God has instituted parties for his glory. This shall be a day, a memorial day, and you shall keep it as a feast, this feast of Passover to the Lord throughout your generations, forever, as a statute forever. And you shall keep it as a feast, the word of the Lord. The Passover meal, or as Dustin would rather us say, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, was established when God delivered or rescued his people, Israel, from Egyptian slavery. Through the Lord's Passover, Israel was delivered. They had been in bondage, in slavery, for over 430 years. Ultimately, this brings about the deliverance of God's people. And because the way in which the Bible would measure things, 600,000 men, along with women and children, were set free, were delivered from slavery in Egypt. There's quite a few things that we can learn, much like we learned last week, about the provision of the Feast of Booths. I want to share with us three things that remind us of the provision of deliverance from the Feast of Passover. Number one is this. I want to remind us of supernatural deliverance. Supernatural deliverance. Most people in this world are seeking out deliverance of some kind. I had the privilege this past week of being a part of a group, and as we began to unpack some things in our lives together, there was one in our group who, it became very clear, needed deliverance from their past. There had been some scars. There had been some damage. There had been some hurts. There had been some loss. I know no one in this room can relate to that at all. You guys have never experienced that stuff, but for the rest of us in this room, maybe we relate. And so what we do a lot of times is we seek out deliverance. And we seek out deliverance, unfortunately, from this world. You want me to tell you why I believe the Mardi Gras culture is so rampant in the city of New Orleans? Although I love this city, and I'm a huge advocate for this city, I believe it's the promised land. And I'm looking to my left right now of a sweet couple that is leaving us. And I'm just weeping, and they're sinning against God leaving this promised land. But here's the truth. New Orleans is hard knock. This is a tough city. I believe one of the reasons why this Mardi Gras culture pops here way more than in other cultures is because people are seeking out deliverance. Even if it's temporary, man, they know that on that parade route later this afternoon, they can get lit up, and not in a good way, these students, lit up in a bad way. And in a brief moment of their life, they are delivered temporarily from their pain, from their struggle. Man, it's a grinded out grind, but man, this weekend a parade's coming. And so, man, I can't wait because my world, Monday through Friday, is hard. And so you find this seeking out deliverance from the world. May I submit to you that the Feast of Passover is a reminder that the world is in need of supernatural deliverance. Something that is not temporary, something that is not of this world. Something that's so above this world, that conquers this world, that's greater than anything in this world. Because I can show you one in this city who's militant. Like if you were to say, this is the number one Mardi Gras attender, I'll still show you someone who has not tapped into fulfillment. Anybody else struggling when you sit back at home and you miss that parade and your friends are showing pictures from the parade? At the end of the day, we get it. I wish I was there, all that kind of stuff. Had sick kids this weekend, couldn't do any parade and all that kind of stuff. And so I'm sitting here just being so envious of all my friends at the parade. But I got to remind myself that, listen, that's not the ultimate. The ultimate is my love for God, my love for my family. Being with my sick kids. That's what's ultimate. The things that God has made ultimate. And so this supernatural deliverance, listen to me. This is from God. This wasn't man's idea. This wasn't Moses' idea. This wasn't anything from the world. This was from God. And listen, my V students are here. V students in the house. Y'all gonna get rowdy? Listen, y'all gotta come party with us on Wednesday nights. These students, this is where it's at, right here on Wednesday nights from 6 to 7:30. We're having a blast. But listen, we talked about, I got to share the word with our V students this past week. We talked about how much God loves us. I got four little kids. It's been a rough week in the Wilton house. They missed most of their school this past week. Kids be acting really disobedient when they're sick. They're hard to love. Just being honest. Even that wife of mine was hard to love this past week. She was a little moody. So pray for me, you know, because I'm struggling. She's been at home and I have to come home and home's in a wreck and somebody's about to slap me right now, right? My kids, listen, even in their darkest, sickest moment, this is what we talked about at V Students this past Wednesday. My love for them as their earthly father never diminishes. I'm telling you, like, literally, my kids sometimes punch me. They're so disobedient. It's so clear-cut disobedience. They're in their anger, even yelling out that they hate me, right? Because I've taken something from them. Not even in that darkest, dirtiest moment do I look at them with any less love. And guys, I'm limited. What about your heavenly father? See, some of y'all are here in this room right now and you're like, oh, I don't know if he loves me anymore. Just think about that illustration. Yes, he does. He sees you, he knows you, he loves you unconditionally. And what this deliverance speaks to is this everlasting love of the Father, doesn't it? He loves us. Romans chapter 5 and verse 8 says this, but God shows his love. Everybody say love. Love. His love for us. In that while we're perfect and going to church every week and doing everything we're supposed to do, he died for us. No. He loved us in that while we were still sinners. Raise your hand if you're a sinner in the house. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. This is a supernatural deliverance. God hears the cries of his people. And they weren't perfect in Egypt, even under slavery. And he brought a supernatural deliverance. He showed up. Anybody needing God to show up? Number two, This is a reconciling deliverance. The beauty of God's presence in our lives is that he doesn't leave us there. He doesn't show up and say, good luck. He shows up and he brings us in. He shows up and he ministers to us. He shows up and he cares for us. And then this is what's so great. You go to that Mardi Gras parade, it fades. Some of y'all may be hurting this morning because it fades. But when you get a touch from God, his love is everlasting. His love never fails. His love never fades. This is a reconciling deliverance. Listen, the people of Israel were slaves. They were in judgment. They were worthy of the wrath of God. When we explain the gospel, we start with God's creation. In the beginning was God. But then we share about our condition, that we fell short of God's glory, and thus sin entered the world through our earthly parents. And because of that sin, God's word says that the wages of sin is death. So we can't read this text and say, oh, well, you should have showed mercy to the people of Israel. No, they were worthy of death. We all are. We're enemies to God because of our sin. But this is a reconciling deliverance, isn't it? What a beautiful thing. God demonstrated his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So God says here in this text, that you must take this spotless lamb. You must kill it a certain way, and then you must wipe the blood on the doorposts. And so what do the people do? They hear the word of God, and then they believe in the word of God. And listen to me, talk is cheap. Believing the word of God becomes real when you walk it out. And so they didn't just, oh, good idea, God, and then go back in their house. No, they did it. And they went and they put blood on the doorpost. And this blood on the doorpost provided reconciliation. It set them free. And it was the ultimate thing that God used to soften Pharaoh's heart, to let the people go. Instead of weeping and loss in these homes, there was now rejoicing and worship. Continuing on in Romans chapter 5, look at verse 9 and 10 now. It says, since therefore we have now been justified by his blood. Christ is all in this passage in Exodus. Justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God that we deserve. For if while we were enemies, maybe you're here today and your only identity is in yourself or in sin. I want you to know that according to God's word, you're an enemy of God. You're either for him or you're against him. You're not in some middle ground here. He still loves you, but until you obey him, believe in him. Listen, when you do, what does he do for us? We move away from being enemies and we're now reconciled to God by the death of his son. Much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. Number three, this is an eternal deliverance. Aren't y'all thankful that the things of God go beyond this world, outlast this world? This world will never satisfy you like Jesus. And this declaration, this event that happens here in Exodus is a prophecy of what will come forever that I want you to know is here available for us today. A spotless lamb had to be slaughtered, and the blood was a sign of faith in God, that God would bless in order for his wrath to pass over. And so this deliverance was a fulfillment of the prophecy that God will never leave us or forsake us if we place our faith in him. The homes that did not put the blood on their doorposts had their firstborn sons slaughtered. So God has provided faith. He's provided salvation. But just because he's declared it doesn't mean you have it. You must give your life to Jesus. And when you give your life to Jesus, this prophecy comes alive. This deliverance, listen to me, is ultimately fulfilled through the spotless Lamb of God, Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 5 and verse 11 continues on after verse 8. All these amazing things. It says more than that. God wants to do more than that, far above, beyond anything we could ever hope, ask, think, or imagine. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. This reconciliation is forever and for all eternity. The blood of Christ covers us forever. Look at this verse, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 10 through 14 says this, and by that will, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Verse 11, and every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away our sins. Verse 12, but when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, verse 13, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. Verse 14, for by a single offering he has perfected for all time, everybody say all time, those who are being sanctified. Listen to me, friends, Christ is our deliverer. He's our deliverer. God has instituted a party for us to celebrate the provision of his deliverance. What Jesus Christ did for me at the age of 7 in New Orleans East at the East Edgewater Baptist Church as my dad preached revival as I was growing up in this city. I want you to know he can do the same for you today. His grace is here. His salvation is here. Christ is our deliverer. I had so much fun this past week calling an old friend of mine. His name's Luke Johnson. He's a missionary in South Asia. Luke used to be on our staff together here in New Orleans. He had the privilege here in New Orleans of leading his wife to the Lord and baptizing her. So we've been so close. He only goes back to Mississippi to kind of raise money, and then he spends the majority of his time going to South Asia to go and tell people who've never even heard about the name of Jesus about Jesus. And he saw that we were doing this series, and so he sent me some notes. He said, man, I just preached on the Feast of Passover. You got to check this out. And also, so we talked, listen, man, unbelievable stuff. This is what he shared with me. I want to share it with you because it was so good. Christ is our chosen lamb. He is our inspected lamb. He is our sacrifice lamb. And he is our indwelling lamb. When you go and study and you go and look at this passage in Exodus, so many of these things point to the prophecy of the fulfillment of Jesus Christ. He is our chosen lambs. Lambs were chosen by each family on Nisan 10. Do you know that Christ rode into Jerusalem on Nisan 10? Listen, he's our inspected lamb. The lamb had to be inspected by the people of Israel to be worthy enough of the sacrifice. Do you know that Christ was inspected on his way to the cross? Do you know that there was never ever sin in his life? He was pure and he was spotless. Christ is our sacrificed lamb. This lamb's blood on the houses was pointing to Christ who would be crucified, as his blood would be the reconciling of all people to the Father. And Christ is our indwelling lamb. The Hebrews had to have a barbecue. And they had to eat of this lamb. And in a sense, listen to me, you cannot receive Jesus until you surrender completely to Jesus. And you have him dwell within you. Isn't that good stuff? Listen, Christ is our deliverer. There's so many beautiful things that speak to this. Let me take you on a quick journey in the New Testament. Do you know that John the Baptist spoke, the Lamb of God is here? In John chapter 1 and verse 29, it says, on the next day, he saw Jesus coming, John the Baptist, toward him. And what does he say? Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Jesus has come. This speaks to that supernatural deliverance. Listen, Jesus came to us. Emmanuel, God with us. He came to save sinners. So there he is. Here's this true Passover. Here's this true Israel. Here's this true substitute with no sin. He's without spot. He's without blemish. He's going to be our substitute. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, Paul writes to the church at Corinth. After Jesus came, he lived, he died, he defeated sin, death, and hell. And he once again speaks of this spotless Lamb of God, speaking to the reconciling deliverance. In 1 Corinthians 5, 7, it says, "For Christ, our Passover Lamb, has been sacrificed." Jesus loves you, and he died for you. And he offers to you the hope of a reconciling deliverance. And then you continue on and you go into the book of Revelation. Do y'all know Pastor Dustin and myself, we're studying right now? This fall, we're going to take a 15-week journey in the book of Revelation. Who's ready for that? Okay, I guess we're going to do something else, Dustin. They're either not pumped up about it or they doubt us, bunch of haters. And so we're going to go into the book of Revelation. So we'll look at this more, but this speaks to the eternal deliverance. Revelation chapter 5, verse 11 through 12 says, "Then I looked and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders, the voice of many angels numbering myriads and myriads of thousands saying with a loud voice, 'Worthy is who? Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing.'" So God's people, every tribe, tongue, language, nation, all peoples, tap into, through faith in Jesus Christ, an eternal deliverance. How about you? How about you? My friend that's right now backpacking through South Asia, sharing the gospel of Jesus right now with people who've never heard about Jesus, gave us a gift as he left us to go and serve the Lord in South Asia. He wrote for us a summary of the gospel. And I want to read this summary of the gospel to you. This is such a beautiful picture of the gospel. He shared this. Jesus Christ is the gospel. The good news is revealed in Christ's birth, life, death, resurrection, and ascension. Christ's death is the heart of the gospel. His resurrection is the power of the gospel. And his ascension, the glory of the gospel. Christ went to the cross in the place of the sinful believer and died in our place for our sin. Christ's death satisfies the demands of God's holy justice, appeases his holy wrath, demonstrates his mysterious love, and reveals his amazing grace. Salvation is found for sinful humanity in no one else but Jesus Christ. Do you know Jesus? Will you celebrate this deliverance today? Just a few moments, I'm going to invite you to give your life to Jesus. He's here. He loves you. He wants you to experience a supernatural deliverance today. He wants you to experience a reconciling deliverance today. He wants you to experience an eternal deliverance today. Because I want you to know, we have some parties. And even on this side of heaven, we have some parties. And y'all love just coming here and worshiping Jesus with Pastor Robert and our band and, man, just getting our praise on, right? Like, man, I just love what God's doing. We're throwing some parties, but it's beyond just worship moments. I'm seeing some of y'all party with your lives. The way in which you're stepping out to share your faith with your coworkers, that's a Jesus party right there. The way in which you're going to serve our friends out in New Orleans East, that's a Jesus party right there. The way in which you're loving your neighbor, that's a Jesus party right there. And I'm going to tell you, all these little parties we're having on this side of heaven will be nothing like the party we're going to have in heaven one day for all time and all eternity. And if you don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you're going to miss it. So don't miss it. Give your life to Jesus and be a part of this amazing party that's found in Scripture. Revelation 19, 6 through 9 speaks of the wedding supper of the Lamb. The wedding supper of the Lamb. It says, then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters and like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, crying out, hallelujah! Hallelujah! For the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exult and give him the glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. We just stop there. Anybody feel they're worthy enough to be before God, bright and pure? Not me. Yet God does for me what I cannot do for myself. He allows me to be washed by the blood of the Lamb. To have this ultimate party for all time and for all eternity. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. That righteousness imputed to us through God in Christ Jesus. And the angel said to me, write this, church. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true words of God. Lord Jesus, we bow before you, trusting in the true words of God, clinging to the truth, celebrating the truth that, Lord Jesus, you have provided for our deliverance. This beautiful, supernatural, reconciling, eternal deliverance. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.